A gang of Gen X cops assembles, trembling before our human nature.
That's true.
Do you ever go to the... When's the last time you went to a library?
If I can have... Since whenever you become married, you and your wife become one.
Uh-huh.
I'm gonna include any... If she's been to any libraries recently. And she actually has. So has I've been she? To a library within the last couple of weeks.
Oh, so you're, I see what you did there. Dude, if I have to stay... If I went to a library, like, I'd be in trouble, man. They'd probably, like... They'd be like, we've been waiting for you. And they'd lock me up.
Yeah, no, Stephanie's
because
like...
Because I've definitely got some unpaid Goosebumps books.
Yeah, her and my sister's, apparently, since she's moved all over, she's... There's... They have a lot of content that you can access, even online. But you need, like, library cards from all these areas. My sister's like, oh, I'm a member at 5 different libraries across the world. I'm like...
5 different libraries?
I don't know.
Golly. That's crazy, man. They're looking for the library. Yeah. What if they did that? What if it was like a secret faction of police they unleashed where they were like, globally, where they're like, we need to get all these people that have late fees. You know what I mean?
Dude, they start putting out like warrants for late fees at the library.
Some kind of science fiction. Yeah.
What?
Bounties.
You're using our resources on people with late books?
Just straight bounties
out
on
there.
Them.
Yeah, but they're not the ones we're concerned with right now, man. we want those late fees.
All right, so. Well, hello and welcome to the Mikey and Me podcast. Thank you for joining us in our little corner of the universe. We hope you're all well.
Our fans.
When you guys are listening to this, you guys are going to be, you know, first of all, sorry. Let me back up. If you're watching and you're joining us for the first time, I'm Mikey. That's me. This is Couch Cam. This is Chris.
Yeah. No.
Me too.
So wait, it goes Couch Cam, then Chris?
I guess. Well, he's the Couch Cam.
Then we have
the
empty guest, and then we have Chris.
Yeah. Okay. There we go. That was
I'm
better.
Just making sure.
So
that's
you do
how
it. Oh, yeah, yeah. Use like Mikey, me, and me too. Oh yeah, that could be a good one. Mikey, me, and me too. Huh? Yeah.
The sequel.
The sequel.
It's a podcast sequel.
But yeah, if you're listening to this, we hope you're listening to this. I should say because there's going to be an apocalypse. I mean, an eclipse that happens today when you're listening to this.
Yeah, actually, if
so,
if,
we're talking to this. We're into the future. Isn't that crazy?
Huh? Yes. We are speaking in the future.
We are speaking to the future right now.
Everything that's in a digital record is speaking to the future.
Incredible.
Everything that goes in every digital piece of information is speaking to the future.
I think we should stop the podcast now with that. That's
the
we're deepest thing.
Everything.
Wow.
Every digital record of everything has led you to this moment. This exact moment. It's a watershed moment
wow.
in Mikey's life.
This really is. I feel like this is like Tenet. Something's like, cue that weird music.
Tenet. I was basically quoting Tenet whenever
were
I was
you?
Saying, yeah.
Wow, I just had deja vu. Huh. That's incredible.
Yep.
All right, so that'll take us into our first subject.
All right,
Mikey. And guys, I got something for you guys this week. I got a couple of little things for you. Not very big, but a couple of things.
Mr. President?
Hold on now. I'm making my round again.
Okay.
But yeah, so we got a couple of little topics here. And the first one I was going to talk about, I found to be most interesting. If my consigliere will move here on the screen to my first topic, which he has done. And if I need him to scroll down, I will. But I'm going to probably pull it out on my phone.
Yeah, you're a man who likes his phone in his hand. It's funny. I don't know if you've gone back and watched. I don't know how often you watch our episodes, but last episode, I think you were toying around on your phone for a lot of it.
Was
movies.
I?
If you weren't, I have to look because I looked like you were, and then I looked and I was looking back and I was like reading through and I looked at you because I didn't see you when I was doing that and you were there like this and you're like uh-huh. I'm like I don't know if you paid attention the whole time.
Well, I did. Well, sometimes I take notes whenever we're doing the movie things. And the other night, it's like I used a piece of paper, so that I don't think I had my phone at all. That
we'll
night
watch the tape using. Later. And we'll
I'll pull paper out. That's actually a good read. I have the book, my little sketchbook with me.
Okay.
Actually, wait. Before we go.
Yeah.
No, before we go into this, actually, we might need to take a quick break because I think we just had like a certain...
Okay.
We might have an opportunity here to do a little segment, and we might just... Yeah, this might be our only chance, so we're going to take a quick break
and see what
come right back. Enjoy the music. Your sword's grown old and rusty, burnt beneath the rising sun. It's locked up like a trophy, forgetting all the things it's done. And though it's been a long time, you're right back where you started. Getting into this little topic that I saw the other day that I thought was like, I don't know, I saw this and I couldn't believe it, but then also I was just like,
unbelievable.
Yeah, and as quickly as I couldn't believe it, then I was like, yeah, no, it seems legit. I guess that I could see that happening. But also, too, it's like, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. It made me think of something that doesn't really relate to it well, so you can keep going.
Okay. All right, so there's a story that I heard of, and it's I'm going to go ahead and go through this article here, and it says, man lived in a shopping center for 4 years after making a secret flat in an unused room. Michael Townsend created a secret apartment in the shopping mall, furnishing it with a sofa and a PlayStation.
Wow.
And lived in it for 4 years before he was found by security and found him facing criminal charges.
It's probably because he's trying to finally steal a TV to play the PlayStation on.
Dude.
Imagine on a PlayStation without a TV.
So it says right here, it says man lived in shopping center. So it's like, it wasn't just that it was a mall, I guess.
So, yeah, a shopping center, it could be like one of those outdoor, like it's a strip mall maybe.
Yeah.
It could be a strip. That I can see that, but it's still just as funny.
And it's how.
Just like, think of like a... Because I can imagine in my area, strip malls, little shopping centers, where there's like, it looks like unused, vacant little areas. And then like, and there'd be like a weird little corner room. You wonder like, what's in that room? Okay, like maybe he was living in one of those rooms.
Well, and so, yeah, so we'll have to try and see if I can find, it'd be cool to find the actual place. If you want to try and look up the guy's name, Michael Townsend, and the mall he lived in, I don't know. It might have been British because the guy like it says flat.
Yes.
And so
on the end, this is referencing pounds in the article.
Okay, so it's got to be in the UK.
Yeah, so it's UK. Okay, here's a picture of it. Oh, yeah, I've got it up right here. They had a PlayStation, and I guess it's implied and assumed that includes this box TV, CRT TV.
Yeah, and so here's the...
He's got a buddy over there.
The article continues.
The picture.
And bro, that wall looks fake as shit, too. Like, he just, like, stacked some cinder blocks on a false wall almost.
Yeah, and like I said, though, he found this place. So here we go. So the article continues, and it says, an artist found himself, quote, a secret flat inside a shopping center, and lived in it without anyone knowing for 4 years, before eventually getting busted and facing criminal charges. Michael Townsend, 52, is an artist through and through and has devoted his life to his trade, making exhibitions for no one to see in an attempt to make sense of the world around him.
This sounds like a story that's a pothead's interpretation of the secret garden, but this is his secret garden. And he's like...
Make a note of that. I want to know okay.
You've never heard of the secret garden? I guess
not.
It's like a timeless kid's story, but
maybe I have. I'm sure
it was a movie.
Yeah,
a movie when you were a kid.
Yeah, it's not. It's boring.
It was more, okay.
It's for girls.
Like, yeah, exactly.
It's like a potheads version of it.
When you were a kid, it came out, but it was more. So
yeah, ain't no guys trying to watch The Secret Garden.
Alrighty, cool.
Whatever. Ain't no men.
And so,
what's a man?
It says, like many in the art community, in Providence, Rhode Island, Michael lived in historic mill buildings in the city that had been left to decay before being repurposed as low-cost homes. that's crazy. Okay, so mill buildings. I wonder what's a
mill. That's but mill sounds like industrial or working Yeah, it's a blue collar area. I'm guessing it's a low income blue collar area.
This again is it's in the UK, so
yeah. So
some of it's out of like I don't know how to, you know.
Yeah.
a mill building to them could be a one bedroom studio apartment. I have no idea what a mill, you know what I mean? Or to us,
there's pictures. They're like sitting there laughing.
Yeah, and so that's the room I'm imagining you.
Oh, this was 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so I'm going to continue on here. It says, but one day in 2003, he found himself facing homelessness as a developer purchased the building where Michael lived and stated it was their commercial, quote, responsibility to develop the building. Michael then visited one of the developer's other projects. So this guy was getting kicked out of this building
okay.
by a developer saying, we need to make this a better place yeah. to live. And then, so Michael goes, he visits one of the developer's other projects, the Providence Place Mall, and he found there was an unused, undeveloped space hidden in the building structure. Taking a leaf out of the developer's book, Michael decided it was his responsibility from an artistic perspective to develop the space. So he moved in and lived there for 4 years before eventually being caught in 2007. That's, so this dude pretty much.
So how old was he when it started? Did it say?
I think it said he was 52. Is what it
now? Was. So that's 20 years ago. So he was in his late 20s, maybe when it started.
No, well, if he's 52 now, if it was 20 years ago.
He would have been 32, but if it was 4 years, if 30, started so, yeah, so maybe 28. 28.
28.
Either way, he's around 30.
Yeah, somewhere in there.
Yeah. An artist. You just all you do is say it was in like he was trying to be like Banksy or an art installation, but Banksy wasn't even around then, I guess. So maybe he was.
No, I feel he was.
I mean, he probably was. Like, he definitely wasn't the name he is now, but he probably was making art then.
Yeah, it was like when he was.
And Banksy could do that now and say it was like an art installation. Banksy can do whatever he wants.
It's just funny the way that like that dude is. Labeled as like whatever, but then like you know dreadlocks over there in fucking
East Dallas. Oh gosh,
fucking teleport across town, you know.
Yeah,
I was just a fucking homeless person.
Yeah.
So I think let me continue on here.
Yep. I'm
gonna get back to that spot. Oh, where did it go? Well, I had it.
But yeah, no. If they write a story about you, it's fucking.
Okay.
Yeah.
Impressive. If it's not, you're just fucking homeless.
Yeah, pretty much.
You just live in East Dallas folklore.
Yeah.
Oh shit, that's dreadlocks.
Yeah.
You just saw him right here.
All
right.
By the way,
dreadlocks was an old white man with long gray dreadlocks that would just teleport.
Yeah.
So he was caught in 2000. He lived there for 4 years and was eventually caught in 2007. Says Michael lived in a mill building called Eagle Square and was gutted when he learned he would have to leave. So he lived in a place that he really liked and was like, hey, man, you got to get out of here.
Well, they weren't paying anybody to live there. Yeah.
Well, and I don't know. I think this was before he did it.
Living rent free is pretty cool.
But I think before he did that, he ended up. Going, but oh, I could okay. be wrong.
I
could
I
be wrong.
Okay. I hear what you're saying.
I could be wrong. Prior he could have already been like a vagabond living in a place that was abandoned, and they were like, "We're tearing it down," and he's like, "Blasted!"
Yeah,
and went on to somewhere else.
Prior to going to this place,
yeah.
Is what you're
so it says right here though, Michael lived in a mill building called Eagle Square, and was gutted when he learned he would have to leave. He said the building, a hangover from the Industrial Revolution, had become a, quote, utopia for artists, where the, quote, cheap space created the time and culture for artists to produce the most incredible, quote, artwork. But progress marched on in the area where Michael once lived for £282, $350.
Like
$7. Yeah. Now is a high-end apartment that rents out for £1,600 or $2,000 a month.
That sounds like Dallas.
So, yeah, he was living in a spot that was really affordable, $350, and then he went up to $2,000 a month place. And it says the development of the mill building left Michael on the verge of homelessness, and true form, his first reaction was to try and understand why this decision had been made by the developer. And so, yeah, then I guess at that point, he decides in doing so, he found a new outlook that would lead to his next major project.
So I'm reading this. So it's telling the story. So he lived in the mill building he lived in is where he lived and he paid rent. This is telling so. Yeah. It's basically once he lived in Mill Building, he lived there. He paid rent. Okay, right. And so, then yeah, so where he ended up living was the town center.
Yeah,
so that's what it is.
He was forced out of the place where.
Yeah.
He was paying low rent. He liked the rent he was paying, and then the developer came in and decided, hey, we're gonna demolish these buildings and make them into nicer places. And so he was paying $350. They demolished the buildings. And then started charging $2,000 a month. And so he was like, well, what?
But he,
the developer that tore his shit down, he then went to one of his other properties.
Yeah.
And then lived in one of his places for 4 years for free.
So he basically kind of got back at the guy.
Because saying, you displaced me in a sense. Like, he was paying a good rate for where he lived. And then all of a sudden, boom. And so now,
it kind of got.
Hey, you want, oh, the guy got what you deserve, whatever. But I mean,
no, it's kind of, I mean, I like it.
Freeloading
it's fun.
First. He wasn't freeloading at first. He then decided, all right, well, you can do this to
no,
me.
Yeah.
You left him, you left him with no recourse.
No, yeah. Well, this is saying that he sat there and watched them all get built and watched it go by and watched it not get used.
Yeah.
And it was, and watched it be a waste and then it saw an opportunity.
Yeah.
And so, well. It looks like, I mean, this article is talking about it, like maybe there is a documentary or there's going to be, but if so, we'll have to check it out. That's for sure.
Yeah, I mean, they definitely have to make, I mean, just trying to think about that. I'd be interested to know what the outside of the place looked like just so I could kind of have a better idea, but I'm trying to think.
Yeah.
Like, as you think in terms of like the shopping centers or the malls near your area and you wonder like where it would be, how could it be?
This right here.
So that's big. That's the place.
It's massive. Yeah.
So that is huge. Okay, so then that makes more sense. So like that's what I was picturing, but then whenever it said town center, I was just kind of like, wait.
Yeah.
Is that like a strip mall like we have by our neighborhoods?
So, yeah. So like I know what you mean.
Like a little L-shaped.
Mikey was telling me about it, like, and that was literally like just on the drive over here was the first I had heard about the story. But I was saying that like I've had just a couple of experiences like in the back type like corridor hallways of like malls like that.
Okay.
One of them was like as a teenager at the Galleria where like everybody goes to go ice skating and shit. And so it was like it was super packed. One of the elevators was really packed and one of my friends who was kind of like a hood rat kind of vagrant type friend.
No, hood rat. We all know this.
That was like, dude, fuck this. We're not waiting on the elevator. And so like, we just go back in this like corridor. We walk through this fucking employee only door and it takes you back into the back.
Okay.
Behind all of the stores.
Okay. Yeah. There's almost like a hallway behind them all. Right. Yes, yeah.
To where like, so like, if you're walking through the mall, you would have to walk all the way up this side and
get to the
way
very
down
end.
And come back down this side to get to the other side.
Yeah, I know what you're talking
where
about.
Where it's like if you went through the employee entrance, you could walk through this doorway, walk through that one, and be on the other side of the mall.
Yeah.
7 feet.
It's access like you've never dreamed.
And so it was like that was my first experience with it. And so it's like it's this whole thing you didn't know existed.
Yeah, it's literally like the secret world underneath. Yeah. Somewhere you're
like
so familiar with
elevators and everything.
Well, that's like have you known about like there's that underground like area or arcade or whatnot here in Dallas that used to be because it was look up Google Dallas's underground.
I know there's the underground stuff like in downtown.
They were developing a whole thing down there. It's like underneath Reunion Tower that connects like a bunch of those buildings.
Well, because I used to go there in high school. I went to high school downtown, and they had tunnels. We would take them.
Yeah.
No, but they had functioning tunnels.
And
that,
so I think now that there's currently, at one point there was an arcade down there. They built like an arcade down there, I believe.
Let's see about arcade.
Sorry.
I don't know if.
But yeah, second experience.
Either way.
Yeah, either way. But no, but I used to
use
it all the time.
Either way, the tunnels in Dallas are crazy. Whenever I looked up and saw photos of them, I'm like, whoa.
No, I'm saying like in high school, we went through them like every day.
And when it was all meant to, I'm pretty sure from the articles I remember reading when I first found out about it, it was that they were, I guess it was just because it was so hot in Dallas and they were trying to create like an underground area that, you know,
like
people that were working in all of those. Well, and people that were working in all those areas, it was an area, like they could walk to the somewhere to go get food and all meet.
Yeah. Well, there was a large bus stop at one of the entrances to the tunnel that was down the street from where I went to school. And we would go there. There was like there's like a freaking little pizza thing at the end of it. Like,
yeah.
They had,
yeah. That was the one where the one homeless guy threatened to stab the other one after we gave him money that day.
Oh, yeah.
He was like, I'll kick you. He was like, I'll stab you. We
were like, yo, gosh, yeah, I forgot about that.
Yeah, we were like 16.
Yeah, it's funny.
Maybe 15.
This the whole idea of tunnels, it's just like it's just like that. It makes me feel like adventure, and you know, and like some movie or so. It's just silly, you know, like you know what I mean. Yeah, like the reason we're even talking about it is like it's just because time, it's like
terrifying.
Yeah, easy turns into the idea of a horror movie.
Well, there was I saw a video on
the tunnel collapsing on you, right? Yes,
I saw a video on.
Yeah.
I've seen a video recently where I don't know if it's real or not, but it looked like these people found like a tunnel that underneath their floor, they like kept catching a draft and like dug up the floor, and it ended up being this tunnel that went pretty like far down and underneath their property out under a major road, and they were saying it like had
New York.
No, it was, I don't know where it was almost like an, you know, a country part of, you know, it was like not like in a big city.
Yeah, either like way, a rural
tunnels
area.
Are That is a creepy deal.
Tunnels, I'll just end to say tunnels, they're a good time.
Tunnels are a good
They time. Might be it scary, but they could be a scary good time.
Like the ones with graffiti on it?
Yeah.
Those are harmless tunnels. Those
yeah, man.
Tunnels. There's nothing wrong with those tunnels. Don't be afraid of those tunnels.
Nope.
All right, so. Let me see. I had another subject.
Yeah, you mentioned something to me earlier that I don't know if I should have been offended by it, but I think that's what you want to talk about.
What?
Well, I'm not going to...
Let's hear it.
You know, you're speaking poorly of those who smile a lot.
Okay.
You know, like something's wrong with them.
I see.
And so maybe I wasn't listening well, but what is wrong with... There's some syndrome with smiling? Like,
well,
what
look,
are we... What
I
are you,
think you misinterpreted, but let me eat this chip. Hold on.
It reminds me, what was it? Look up the end credits of Toy Story 2.
I hope he's joking.
No, where it's the Barbie.
So we can we'll show that at the end in a sense, because that might be kind of the people will get his reference. No, but yeah, he's right. So there was this thing that I saw, and it was called SMS, and I was like, that sounds like some sexual stuff.
Well, SMS messages, text messages.
Oh,
that's immediately what comes to mind for me.
Me and Matthew send, right?
Yeah, that's what I mean. That's what I mean. That's what I thought of too.
Yeah. You gonna leave me hanging?
Android for life.
Android for life.
So
no FaceTime.
SMS is actually smile mask syndrome, and you might want to bring this up, or if you already have it up, go to that tab. I think you have it up already.
I'll bring it back up.
Switch it over, Daddy. Also, see, are the UFC fights happening? Put them on the TV. What are you doing? I think you got them up. But
it wouldn't start it. Look, this is how I don't record things, Mikey.
Yes,
that's how it happens. It's all my fault, though.
Sorry,
guys.
You
don't know what we're talking. What did you want to talk about?
Smile mask syndrome.
Yeah, you can talk.
Daddy, now calm down now.
Yeah. See, this girl has it.
Okay, so
maybe.
And this is crazy. This is something. Now see if you can get the fight pull up. Now I'm gonna make you do other things.
Okay, and I'll listen to you at the same time.
Thank you for listening. I'll wait for you.
No, really just keep talking, because I'm not that interested in this, honestly.
See, I love that Matthew's not that interested in this. He says he's not. But
yeah, I'm just waiting to talk about movies.
There's going to be a movie that pops up, and he's going to be like, hey, man, so there was this movie that came out about people that smile all the time.
This exact scene.
All right, yeah. So here's the thing.
A friend suffering as his one friend tells him about something
exactly
interesting and then something
like
that's kind of
Toy
interesting.
When you get done with it, he's going to be like, oh, that's exactly
yeah,
like
so pretty much quickly, smile mask syndrome is something, the origin of it was this guy in Japan, Natsumi, I don't know where his last name is.
Oh, the Chingoku.
No, not Chingoku. proposed a
Sudoku,
disorder
yeah.
after consoling students from the university in his practice and noticing that a number of students had spent so much time faking their smiles that they were unaware that they were smiling, even while relating stressful or upsetting experiences to him. Natsumi attributes this to the great importance placed on smiling in Japanese service industry, particularly for young women. The description says, "In smiling is an important skill for Japanese women working in the service
it's
industry."
It's a skill. So smiling is a skill. I'm just learning.
Like, he he's saying
in their industry.
No, I'm just learning. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, in the industry. Says also all.
Why don't you fucking smile?
It says also all service industry companies in Japan require their female staff to smile for long periods of time. Natsumi says that his female patients often talk about the importance of smiling when the topic of conversation is on their workplace. He relates examples of patients saying that they felt their smiles had a large effect on whether they were hired or not.
Well, so, getting a job, smiling at a job interview is a duh, right?
Well, no, he's talking. Yes,
but no, we're talking about after that. I'm just making just that statement there is addressing something that's like, okay, a job. But yeah, them being expecting such a nonstop smiling face.
Yeah,
and it sounds like it's really affecting women more.
Essentially what I gather as well is because.
So we're safe. We don't have to worry about getting this.
No, we don't have to worry about getting this.
Okay, cool. I'm just making sure.
It says...
what are your pronouns?
He's got a point.
I can't remember where I left off. It says pretty much what he goes on to say is that, let's see, problems. Just since I've introduced you to the fact that this is mainly happening in Japan, and I think they've also identified somewhere Korea was also somewhere that this was happening.
It's definitely not happening but it in says, North Korea. There are no perpetual smiles in North Korea.
It says
A lot of what really like 20 under par golf games by the leader. But yeah, that's different.
That is true.
Yeah.
He's like, I'm the best in golf. Yeah. So the problem, smile mask syndrome can cause physical problems as well as mental ones. Natsumi relates that that many of his patients develop muscle aches and headaches as a result of prolonged smiling, and says that these are similar to the symptoms of repetitive strain injury.
I'm a little on the fence about this even having a Wikipedia page. I believe that people have to do things in their job and have to have a strained face. They named it that. That's fine. But I feel like whatever it is, like this, it's having headaches and all these things and other things. I think there's not forms of not smiling that's having the same detrimental effect on people. It's just funny.
It very well could.
I'm just being the skeptic.
The point that he's making in this.
Oh, I wasn't making.
No, Chris, I get the point he's making, but then I'd be like, okay, that's cool.
it's more so the importance that that courtesy is placed, you know, in Asian culture, where you know, it's always important to smile and be polite, and that's even one of the conversations that we had on the way over here was where it was like, here, if I walk into a store and somebody's like, hey, you know, smiling, how can I help you? I'm like, get the fuck out of my face. I know what I want.
Yeah,
I don't need your help. But over there, it's like they have a different.
It's a different game.
But yeah, and they place value on that.
Either way, that was just something.
So it's one of those things where it's like they want to always portray that.
I like this comment on this Reddit post. It's a culture specific disorder. It definitely seems to be a culture specific disorder.
That's what I was 100%.
That's what I was trying to get.
That's the thing that's crazy about it though. Is like, could you imagine that it's like?
So don't, you know, if your girl just. Don't accidentally get a job in Japan.
Yeah.
And you should be good.
Alright, so going on to the best movies.
Okay, well, give me 30 seconds. That was the longest break. Okay. All right, Mikey. So, I was interested in what you were saying last time. There's a lot that has and hasn't happened, and there's evidence of things that haven't happened. But we are on to 2004, Chris.
We are.
Yeah.
The movies.
Yes.
And whereas in weeks past where I've been here and I've had a chance to at least a cursory glance at the movies, this week. I have been given no glance.
Which is exactly how we want this. That's
well, and it is.
We prepared. We perfectly prepared you. Unpreparedness was the form of preparedness.
And that is kind of the preparedness.
All right.
That I have.
So in 2004, right? Let's see. Let me get to the right year, good folks. So, Million Dollar Baby won the Academy Award for Best Picture, right? And I guess, technically, Crash came out, I think, at the end of 2004. And it won the Best Picture in 2005. But, yeah. And then Aviator came out 2004. Sideways won the Golden Globe for Best Motion Picture. Incredibles came out that year. Got Academy Award for Best Animated Feature. We had our Super Size Me, the documentary, come out. That got the best documentary film. So, yeah. So, that was 2004. So, we're going A to Z. You might be over, you know, I've definitely gone back and I'll get Mikey to read some of these because I definitely threw a handful of them. But we're going A to Z. Here we go. And A to Z actually means 0 to Z. 13 going on 30 is the first one. So Jennifer Garner, she pretends she's a young girl. I remember that. She's done that in multiple movies. She's played a woman who has a younger woman, a girl trapped in an adult's body.
Yeah, wasn't that
and, arguably, no, but I think that, she's been in three or four movies where she does that, so at least she's practiced
honestly,
in it.
Honestly, though, in the movie The Kingdom, she had a scene where it was like Jennifer Garner was hands down one of the most badass bitches ever.
No, yeah, dude. That scene, I give her respect. Like, yeah, you know, she married Ben Affleck, and I think that's the only thing. So, but then 51st Date. After the Sunset. Yeah.
We're like the cast. Yeah, of 51st Date.
Yeah, I see. After the Sunset, Against the Rope. Okay, Mikey. This is you again, Agent Cody Banks 2, Destination London. We won't talk about it more because I know you get worked up. The Alamo, Alexander.
I remember being excited for The Alamo, going to see it. It was okay.
Had Dennis Quaid, Billy Bob,
it's one I need to watch again. Watched it in theaters and then never watched it again.
Yeah.
I need to watch it again and see the story.
It's funny. It's the thing about The Alamo is the quote, "Remember the Alamo." It's just funny because at the end of the day, it's not the most memorable of it.
That was the Battle of Gonzales.
Oh, okay. It was following the Alamo, but I'm just saying, as far as remembering the Alamo, they should actually make a movie, The Battle of Gonzales. Is it Samson? Gonzales, that's my neighbor.
Gonzales was the cannon.
Yeah. Okay. Then we had Alexander. He has Oliver Stone's big foray into kind of that those classic eras. It was right. Yeah, Rosario Dawson exposed herself, so there's that. Alfie, Mikey, you good so far? Alfie, that's a remake. Jude Law. Okay, Alien versus Predator came out that year, which this one was disappointing. This was disappointing because this is when they ventured into a PG-13 Alien and Predator movie.
It was with the girl, right? The girl ended up being the one that,
it's just more, and any Alien or Predator movie should never be PG-13. And I feel like they recognized it whenever the next Alien Requiem came out, because that was the most ridiculous R. Like, a little kid gets his chest burst at the beginning of the movie. I remember I was at the quarry, we're in Denton, and we started laughing. Like, this is ridiculous. Alien? No, in the Alien movie that came out right after Alien versus Predator.
Oh, I got it.
So it's like, they came out with the PG-13, then they came out with a ridiculous R. Like, there was... A
hard R?
A hard R. Let's see, Along Came Polly. A lot of people probably like that,
That was a good one.
Riding the Ben Stiller, still in his heyday. Him basically playing the same character, but still was funny. It's where he dances again. Oh, you know what? If it's so, then that makes Iceman. If Philip Seymour Hoffman's his buddy in there, yeah, his moments in that movie are what make that movie. Yeah. Honestly, you see, character. America's Heart and Soul, Anaconda's the sequel to Anaconda. Okay, this is. I mean, and I had thoughts at the from our last week watching it again. I'm gonna like have a couple two top picks, but I'm probably wanna mention it. Then have at least two honorable mentions. And
oh,
of
why
course,
don't we just mention them all?
Why don't we just mention them all? Yeah, no, we're about to skip.
Just watch all movies.
This one is important. Okay. Anchorman, The Legend of Ron Burgundy.
No, but that is the original.
Right? Anchorman, yep, like, no, this is the first one. Anchorman, yeah.
Like seeing like.
Yeah, no, it's Anchorman, the first one. Legend of Ron Burgundy.
That's the whole title.
Adam McKay. Directed it, you know, from SNL. Will Ferrell, man, this movie changed a lot of people's lives. Anchorman, it nailed it. It nailed the landing.
It was a good movie.
It's hilarious.
Yeah,
good.
I love it.
It's absolute. This movie was incredibly fun. All right, around the bend, around the world in 80 days. Oh, Jackie Chan, Steve Coogan. Oh yeah. Steve Coogan, he's a Brit that I really like. He didn't catch on over here.
He was great. Sesame,
Richard
Coogan.
Yes, yeah. Good job.
Yeah.
So, the Avial. This is a big one. I didn't get all the way through this movie.
it's
okay, and The Aviator.
I thought it was interesting. I mean,
The Aviator is the one I'm saying. So, Martin Scorsese's film.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting the part where, like, Leonardo DiCaprio, who is playing Howard Hughes, is getting so upset because he had spent all this money and budget filming all these planes flying through the sky, but he was so raging mad because he was like, you can't, it's like there was no clouds or anything, so you had no frame of reference of how fast they were going. It just looked ridiculous, and he's mad, and so I was like, we need to add clouds, and they're just like running around like, shit, because the time of year, like, there was no clouds, so it was like, they had to make clouds, and so,
and they just have really, to do whatever the boss, like,
yeah,
whatever, you know,
exactly.
He's top dog.
So I just thought it was hilarious because, like, and it also showed just kind of what a madman he was.
Yeah, yeah. The classic agoraphobia. Agoraphobic. Ooh, Barbershop 2. Before Sunset. This is a Richard Linklater. This is, like, the beginning of, I think this is the first of, like, a 3 or 4 part series of movies that he made with Ethan Hawke and Julie Delpy. No, it's the second. Before Sunrise came out first. Which Richard Linklater has done a lot of he's done a lot of important movies. But yeah, it's honestly probably y'all fall asleep watching it. Being Julie, Benji, oh yeah, the best thief in the world. I'm gonna let you take over the seas, Mikey, and you can skip or read which ones you want. Beyond the Sea. I'm saying this because Kevin Spacey directed and starred in it, and Kevin Spacey is no longer with us. No, it's let's see, The Big Bounce. Okay, this next one is one of my. There's a chance it's one of my picks. I'm not gonna lie. I looked through this list last night and already know my two picks.
Okay,
this might be one of them. Birth. This is a movie by Jonathan Glazer's second movie. His first movie, you might have heard of him because it's relevant now because his movie that he just released, that it was one of the movies nominated for Best Picture. I'm just drawing blank now. The one about the Auschwitz. Hold on. It was literally just that. The Zone of Interest. So he just did The Zone of Interest, which it won in multiple Academy Awards. Before that, he did this really, really avant-garde sci-fi movie, Under the Skin, that had Scarlett Johansson in it, which is probably like her most unique role, which is like, it's
yeah,
a really tripped out.
The prison guard?
No, Under the Skin is where she's an alien and she doesn't ever really talk. She hunts guys, traps them in this ridiculous, like, surreal large underwater pool. It's not that one.
Schindler's List.
His Zone of Interest is the one that just came out, and it's about the guy who there was about the guy who was like the commandant or whatever, basically the general manager of all of it, but it never shows inside.
In the background.
Yeah, no, you barely hear background noise of it. It doesn't actually show or address any of the things that happened there. Yeah. And that was like it was literally like, wow, these are like a normal guy with a normal life and family who manages Auschwitz. It was just, yeah. But so this is that director. So this was the second movie, Birth, which is just, honestly, it's an odd movie, but it really just sticks with you. And it starred Nicole Kidman, is really the main takeaway as far as people recognize 04. Cameron Bright, yeah, 04. And the premise is she had a husband who she was obviously madly in love with, who tragically passes away, and she's about to be remarrying some other guy, and some little boy shows up who's like got to be like 12 or something, 13, mm-hmm. and like starts saying that like, I'm your reincarnated dead husband, like, and knows all these facts and information that she can't find any explanation that he could possibly know outside of like actually being her deceased husband. Really? So that's the premise. And that, you know, how it all plays out, it's worth checking it out. But yeah, it's just, yeah, but it's just and Jonathan Glazer, another director like many, he got his start in music videos and commercials, and has did a lot of work. So he's only actually made like 4 or 5 movies in his career. Like Sexy Beast came out in like 99 or 2000. This came out in 04. Then he'll have like 10 years between movies, but every one of his movies is very striking and unique. And they've each been a different genre, incredibly different genre. So if he even ever makes another movie, then we're checking out. So yeah, Birth. Obviously, I talked about that one. So I'm assuming we got Blade Trinity. It was a Black Cloud. I mean, it was entertaining. Butterfly Effect.
No, that's
Book
not
of Love.
Black.
The Blue Butterfly. Book of Love. Born Supremacy. We're gonna breaking all the rules. Rated Jones. Brother to Brother. Oh, there's a Butterfly Effect. Yep. Look at that. I saw the future.
You did. Whoa.
That's weird. And there ends the bees. And I know some people, it's passable. It's probably Ashton Kutcher's best movie, for whatever that's worth. You know, it's a slight, yeah. It's not the worst thing you could put on.
I thought it was a decent, I think it would have been a decent, well, what would you, foray, I guess you would call it, into, what is that?
Yeah.
Is that the word I'm looking for?
Yeah, foray. That works.
For people into that realm of stuff.
Yeah.
Because it was somewhat easily graspable, and it was not only that, but it was a really popular person at the time, and so it could have been somebody that they end up watching it because it's like, oh, Ashton Kutcher, but then it like opens up this whole world.
Yeah, of time travel implications
that they would have never even looked into because of, you know.
The director's cut version of it was neat too, because it was like it did show that there were several different endings.
Yeah.
To the movie. Oh, sorry.
Oh, there you're good.
Enough into it. But honestly, it was funny too, because right after I was living with Salazar when we like first saw that movie. Just on a side note, we had just finished watching that movie, and Michelle came over, closed the front door really hard when she came in, and Salazar looked at her and was like, what the fuck are you doing? You just created an earthquake or a tsunami on the other side of the world. And it was literally when the big tsunami happened, what was it, in like Thailand or Malaysia?
Yeah.
In like the early 2000s.
Yeah.
It was like literally the next day. And it was just like one of those things where it's like, we had nothing to do with it, but we just got done watching the movie.
Yeah. The,
and it was like somebody made reference to it. And then it was like, and then the next day on the news, you're like, and it was like, are you?
Yeah. The confluence of events to occur. There's just like, it's still, it's,
tell her that she didn't do that because she really thinks she killed.
Yeah. And I remember Michelle, and she was the kind of girl who might believe that.
Like, yeah, she would be, oh my God.
Yeah.
Very impressionable.
Yeah. All right. So Mikey, I'll let you do the C's. If you,
all right. Catch that kid. Well, if I'm going to be honest with you and give you guys some advice, I'd recommend not catching kids. It's not a good hobby. Catwoman, Cellular. What is this? Cellulose?
Yeah, you can.
Yeah, that's
what? You can go as fast or slow as you want through these. Let's see. Okay, well, don't skip Chronicles of Riddick, because that's a good one.
That was actually, was
Chronicles of Riddick
was
is
that
good.
Number, was that the very first one?
No, Pitch Black was first. Black. Yeah, oh, yeah, after Pitch after Black, yeah. So Pitch Black, which, whenever it was released, you wouldn't even necessarily know it was really a sci-fi horror movie, a thriller. But,
people
yeah.
wanted it like they wanted, what was the movie The Fugitive?
Yeah.
With Harrison Ford. They wanted a movie based on Tommy Lee Jones' character in The Fugitive, which is what they got when they made the movie U.S. Marshals.
Yeah.
Based directly off.
Yeah,
of
it's
character.
Just like that. So, yeah, and this is so the this is a movie Black, based off the character from Pitch Black, Black Vin Diesel's
Riddick.
Character.
Yeah, Pitch Black, Riddick was a
And it was a good, and they actually had some good video games, too.
But yeah,
Escape from Butcher
Chronicles,
Bay.
Chronicles of Riddick, like the very first one after Pitch Black, was a pretty good movie.
Yeah, and so the next one you got A Cinderella Story with Hilary Duff. Yeah, that's Matthew's favorite.
Oh, there we go.
The Clearing, Clifford's really big move, The Closer, Cloud Cuckoo Land.
Club Dread. Club Dread, funny. It's worth watching it. That's
my jam.
Yeah, it's the broken whatever lizard.
Collateral.
Or,
there's one for Chris.
Ooh.
I know he already wrote that down.
Collateral. That. Mike, Man. Classic Collider. Michael Mann. There's a Tom Cruise, Jamie Foxx. There's a lot of good stuff in that one.
Communication Breakdown, Confessions.
Yes.
Confessions of a Teenage Drama Queen, Connie and Carla, Control Room, The Cookout, Crash.
Crash. Oh, that's a movie that won Best Picture the following year. But
Crash was really good.
No, but the thing about this, okay, so Crash wins Best Picture the next year. It's probably regarded as the worst movie to have won Best Picture.
Really?
Yeah, and they even say there's speculation that it won like it wasn't even supposed to be the true winner. Huh. I don't know. Like if you just Wikipedia that movie, you'll find a lot of stuff on going back and watching it and it really kind of not being
it.
As
I have it on DVD. Yeah.
Yeah, and it really being, even though it's like trying to be a dramatic thing, like it's leaning into stereotypes pretty hard, like very hard, like so hard that it would be like very frowned upon right now. Yeah, and even in 2004 and 5, it was leaning so hard that it was like it was even a thing.
Who was the white guy? Was it
Matt Dillon?
Matt Dillon. Yeah. Where it was like he was like the virulent.
He's one of those large ensemble casts.
The virulent racist cop.
Yeah, it's just really leaned into these dramatic stereotypic tropes.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah. So there's that.
Carry us on. I'm done with the C's.
Okay.
So carry on the D's.
Okay. Here we go. See. Dawn of the Dead. This might be Zack Snyder's best movie, honestly, because it was a remake. But and as far as remakes go of a movie, This might be, for me, one of my, I think, the best remakes. I'm not even necessarily a huge Zack Snyder fan, but I think he did a great job with this.
Well, and that's not even your genre.
No, it's not. See, Day After Tomorrow came out, Day at the Mexican Delivery.
There's a lot of good comedies that came out this year.
Oh, yeah. See, Dirty Dancing, Havana Nights. Man, Mikey, we had some fun there.
Yeah,
Dirty Shame.
Really
ooh,
did.
Dodgeball. Oh, Dodgeball, man. That's a quotable favorite.
Got it right there.
That's a quotable. Dodgeball. And this is one of those comedies that even if I weren't going to sit there and be like, it shouldn't be on there, if I went back and how many times I've quoted stuff from this movie, it's like, it had an impact on me.
You can dodge a wrench, you can dodge a bite. Necessary? Is it necessary?
Yeah, and I put this on for my mom, and she even laughed. Like, if my mom laughed, like, it's...
That tells you something.
Yeah.
It's accessible.
See, The Door on the Floor, Ella Enchanted, Envy. Oh, Envy was the goofy comedy. Ben Stiller had so many... Man, it's funny when actors are on a tear. This is one where they had, like, that Poo Be Gone spray. It was goofy. Oh, Eternal Sunshine, Spotless Mind, Jim Carrey, Kate Winslet. I was... Man... This is really good.
I remember it getting hyped up really.
You never saw this?
I mean, I feel like I did, but
it's really good.
What is it about? The touched guy?
Yeah. No, it's basically about the idea of like, if you want to like forget a bad relationship or forget somebody, like, because it's thinking like you can't be with them and you love them, but you can't, or that sort of thing. And you could just have the memories erased, you know, and like that being some like experimental treatment. It's about some guy who like is going undergoing that to have his like memories of this relationship. So it's really. Yeah, it's Jim Carrey, and this is like one of his early like dramatic turns.
Yeah, I remember it being hyped because it was Jim Carrey's one of his steps outside.
It took me a long time to watch it. I didn't watch it for over 10 years after it came out because I kind of got it. Like,
I
as far as
opening day, I went and saw it opening day.
Yeah, and then you fell asleep, it sounds like, because you don't remember.
I watched it, but I was, you know.
Yeah,
I
so either way.
I got done listening to a fugue played by Bach. So
Bach has some good fugues, man. Exorcist Beginning, Euro Trip, Fade to Black, ooh, Fahrenheit 9/11, Fat Albert, Finding Neverland, oh, Johnny Depp, The Final Cut, First Daughter, Fly the Phoenix, Forgotten, 40 Shades of Blue, Friday Night Lights. You know what was for me cool about this movie? Explosions in the Sky did the soundtrack, and that is a post-rock band who's from Texas. And if you're familiar with post-rock, they're like one of the, you know, prominent, premier, you know, mainstays and pioneers in the genre. As far as, you could argue that. But they did the soundtrack, and so it's just cool. And it's a really well-done movie, but I don't really care about it. But I just like the soundtrack. Again, Garden State, Zach Braff from the Doctor sitcom. Didn't see it, didn't care to see it. I was annoyed by the commercial. Garfield the movie, The Girl Next Door, Elisha Cuthbert.
This is
probably the peak of whatever she had to offer.
It wasn't even her. It was fucking what's his name?
Tom Green?
No.
No, he's not in that one.
Timothy Oliphant's character.
Yeah, he's a steam sealer, man. Yeah, I love Timothy Oliphant.
Timothy Oliphant in that movie, like.
Him at the end of freaking Go. I don't know if you remember the movie Go. He's at the that drug dealer at the end of Go.
Well, he was that dude in The Girl Next Door.
No, I'm just saying it was like a similar role. So that it was a similar. He played a similar character type.
For me, he was like, I want you.
Yeah.
So I got you, bro.
Oh, The Grudge. Oh, Harold and Kumar Go to White Castle. A lot of classic stoner, I guess, a classic stoner comedy.
Not great.
Yeah, I mean, it was like, Mikey, because you're younger than me. How do you feel about this?
I really liked it. I mean, I loved it. I remember that makes sense. I'm somewhat nostalgic to it because I remember watching it with my brother Caleb. We both got a good kick out of it. There's still a line to this day that we quote, which is where there was a guy in it. This is also one of those movies that has a cameo in it of a guy that you would have never guessed that he was in. You would have never guessed it that it was him, but it was the guy that played Detective Stabler, Elliot Stabler in SVU. You probably know exactly what his real name is.
No, I don't know his name.
But he played the character of Freak Show, where he had like a bald cap on and wild hair, and he picked
wait, is
up.
It that?
No, he's like driving. He's like driving. I heard everything. Like, you guys can blah blah blah. Come back to my house, fuck my wife. Yeah. And then they were like looked at each other, like, "Whoa, did he really just say that?" And then he had like a boil on his neck,
like
Chris
pulsing.
Said.
That
yeah,
was like pulsing.
And
the
so
whole
they
time
go back to talking. His house, and they're like, "Oh my god, where does this guy live?" But then he's like, "You go inside his trailer, and it was super nice." And then his wife was like super smoking hot.
19-year-old
dime. Dude, she was just like, this chick was fine. But then either way, it's like. He ends up, you know, either way, that was just a good movie.
Now, there's a scene, that scene like you're talking about, though, is there's a scene during the house, and he's outside, and he's dancing to himself. And I remember watching that. I don't even like the movie, but that scene there is one of the funniest scenes.
And that's what I'm saying. So it has a bunch of those scenes, in my opinion, and, like, whenever they're out there peeing on a bush, he's like, is this your bush?
Oh, yeah, that was Jamie Kennedy.
Yeah, and Jamie Kennedy popped up in it.
Yeah, in the truck with his neck.
Yeah, so it's worth checking out if you haven't seen it these once.
Yeah, it's a funny one.
Oh, Hellboy, Guillermo del Toro, Ron Perlman. I like that definitely more than what they tried to do recently, with a dude from what's it called? Either way, Her Summer, Hidalgo. That did not go over well.
I liked it.
Oh, I mean, yeah, Viggo I like Viggo Mortensen. You know, I wish it did better.
Violence, Eastern Promises.
Oh yeah, yeah, dude. History of Violence is so good. See, Home at the End of the World. Home
Highwayman.
Right. Ooh, Hotel Rwanda. That's actually a pretty good movie.
Highwayman. Did you ever see that one with Jim Caviezel?
No, I didn't. So
that was actually a pretty decent one. He played like, I don't know, he was like a begrudged husband whose wife had gotten like, I don't know, something happened to her in a wreck, something. The police like didn't really investigate it either way. He takes it upon himself, I think, to find this guy.
Oh, like vigilante justice kind
of? Sort of, yeah, but it's around a car. Like both the guy that, like, guy's like a serial killer that kills people with a car. Jim Caviezel pretty much is trying to just track him down. But it's okay. Really an interesting movie because it's just based around like a serial killer in a car. And Jim Caviezel's also trying. I mean, you just have to check it out. I think it's worth a look.
Okay. So yeah, Home at the End of the World, Home on the Range, Hotel Rwanda, Hunting of the President, I Heart Huckabees. That was a quirky movie. David O. Russell. He did, he did that one kind of Desert Storm movie with George Clooney.
Shit.
You know which one I'm talking about.
Wait, the director? Three Kings.
I was about to say Three Kings, but for some reason it didn't sound right.
Mark Wahlberg, yeah. Cube, and George Clooney.
Yeah, see, iRobot. I wished iRobot was good, but I just didn't.
We're living in iRobot.
Imaginary Heroes, The Incredibles. Oh, look at that! In Good Company, Jailbait. It's a Jersey Girl.
That's what I was saying.
Yeah,
this,
yeah.
This is 04.
This is 04. Another Kevin Smith. Kevin Smith has made more bad movies than good movies.
But that's what they call that whole crew, like Ben Affleck. Fucking Kevin Smith, all them, they call them like the Jersey Girl like crew.
Huh. I don't know. I mean, Kevin Smith has done a handful of things with Ben Affleck. But I'm honestly, Kevin Smith, he did Clerks.
Yeah.
Clerks, Mallrats, and the Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back.
Yeah.
Are for me the only ones like I could watch again. No, I don't have any desire. Like I don't really think.
They call that crew the Jersey Girl. I didn't realize that Jersey Girl came out so late.
Oh yeah.
Mallrats and everything came out.
Yeah, those already come out. Yeah, John Stefan, Vacation King, Kill Bill Volume 2 came out. So yeah, Volume 1 came out in 2003. And for me, these, it's like one big movie to me. So it's King Arthur. Oh yeah, Clive Owen. And dude, it's your boy Antoine Fuqua directed that.
Yeah.
So Kinsey, that was good. Lanny's Turn, Knots, Ladder 49, The Lady Killers. That was a Coen Brothers movie. Right, yeah. That's a good movie. Tom Hanks, the Coen Brothers.
Did you see that?
Yeah.
I love that. He was like, when he goes down to the basement, he was like, his basement is the perfect it has the perfect acoustics. It was like the catacombs that would use for yakking. He was like,
down there in the catacombs. Mikey is the only person that remembers the Lady Killers.
I know, it's fun.
He loves it.
Because the dude talking about IBS, a good IBS, no cure, only control. you can't cure IBS, you can only control it. And he's got his one lady with him, and the guy gets mad. He's like, you brought your bitch to the Waffle Hut, the Wayans brother.
Man, Coen Brothers always killers, give you something worth watching.
The Lady Killers. It sucks for me that there's so many great comedies. For me, this is
this is above a comedy though, dude.
It is above a comedy, but it's still too, a comedy.
That's what's great
comedy, but
whenever the Coen Brothers like are doing for them what's straight up comedy, it's something special, honestly.
Yeah, but either way,
Land Has Lies, The Last Shot.
I already see one for Matt.
Lemony Snicket's Series of Unfortunate Events. The Life and Death of Peter Sellers. Ooh.
Life Aquatic
with Steve Zissou. Wes Anderson film. So when this came out, honestly,
speak on it, young man.
And when it first came out, I wasn't as touched by it. But, you know, going back over the years, watching it, you know, more than once, I've really grown in it. In the World of Tenenbaums is one of my favorite movies. So it's not Wes Anderson for me. It's like I feel like he made for me his bet, like his first, you know, main release. Well, I mean, I Bottle Rocket, but like I don't know, one of his earliest releases, The World of Tenenbaums, is like just for me like a perfect movie. And so it, I guess I just still was just comparing things to that. But the Life Aquatic is actually, I think for me, it's pretty phenomenal. I like it. It's a Little Black Book, Love Song for Bobby Long.
Wait.
So I know this one in the Smith household is the whole fan. Whatever's going on.
That's
Bob's Man on Fire.
Bob has
Tony Scott Denzel Washington film that, I'll tell you what, man. This is peak Tony Scott. This is peak. I mean, Denzel, honestly, he still delivers. So,
yeah, the
Man
Glock,
on Fire, man.
The Glock not fire.
Yeah, dude, Man on Fire is an amazing movie, and if you have not seen that, that's one of Denzel's best movies.
Yeah, what's the premise again?
It's he's like a retired something or another,
he's
contractor,
like
military guy,
forces,
CIA, whatever.
Like, seen everything.
Yeah,
just totally,
and he ends up like getting hired by this guy to look after his daughter. This guy is like somebody who's who's super rich and lives in Mexico. And the guy more or less has to have his kids looked after because people will come kidnap your kids.
Yeah, and extort them or extort you.
And so he is the bodyguard for this girl. And
he takes it under the pretense that it's just a bullshit job. Like,
He's not emotionally attached.
Like, you just need to look out for a kid.
Yeah, what's the big deal?
Attached.
Just look out for some kids.
It is
fantastic.
It's an adrenaline rush. Manchurian Candidate. This is a remake. It was decent, but I like the story of the Manchurian. Story.
The execution came a lot better.
Based on the
1960s. Yeah, exactly. It was a remake.
It's a remake.
Yeah, and even it's a cool story, but you might not find it as interesting watching that interpretation. Maria Fuller Grace, me, you, and everyone we know. If my wife, I might have for Stephanie. This was like an indie film that I had no interest in seeing, but my wife Stephanie, she for whatever reason, has a fondness for it. So I watched it with her, and it has some really funny moments in there. And there's even if you've played the very offensive game Cards Against Humanity, there's a at least one version that has a card that's directly referencing something from this movie that you wouldn't have ever guessed, because it said something about like pooping back and forth forever or something really goofy. But it's a quirky indie film. This for you, Stephanie, as I was talking about it. And I enjoyed it. Mean Creek, Mean Girls. I have no desire to go out of my way to watch this movie, but if I'm forced to, it's entertaining. Meet the Fockers. It's funny. It's funny. Merchant of Venice. Melinda. Million Dollar Baby. That did quite well. Best Picture. Best Actress. Hilary Swank. Clint Eastwood. Most interesting death in a boxing ring. But I'm not going to say anything else. Mind Hunters. Ooh, Miracle. That was cool about the hockey team. The one the... was that the 80 something beat the Russians? Yeah, that is a really good movie.
Kurt Russell highlighted in it.
Shout out Michael Salazar. That's his favorite.
Yeah, it's a good. I mean, it's a real good movie. Let's see. Do you want me to keep doing it, Mikey?
Yeah, keep going.
Okay. Misbehaviors, Modigliani, Mojados, Mondovino. No, the Motorcycle Diaries. This is actually a foreign film. Gael Garcia Bernal, the main actor, and actually Pedro Luna's in here too. I don't know why he's not listed here. But yeah, Gael Garcia Bernal, he's a Hispanic actor that I like a lot. Yeah, Mr. 3000 or Bernie Mac, R.I.P.
I feel like that's one Mikey and I need to rewatch.
Dude, I love Bernie Mac.
I really
liked his show. It was one of the shows the reruns came on. His delivery on...
Bust your head to the white meat show through.
Yeah. Mr. 1000. I never even saw it, but I should just because I much like Bernie Mac. My Daddy's Baby. Oh, Mysterious Skin. Napoleon Dynamite came out this year, too. Man. And this is a movie that I don't want to like, but it's freaking great.
Same.
I don't want to like it, but it is phenomenal.
Broker Caxix.
It's man. I know. It's this. It's man. It's greatness. National Treasure. Neville Dareline, New York Minute. Oh, that Olsen Girls. Noel. Oh. This moves. This moves the barometer for many. I've heard more guys give this for a romance movie. Get this respect, so you know that they did something right. You know they did something right. No, The Notebook. The Notebook. They somehow made a romance story that can guys can be down with.
Yeah, it's not bad.
It isn't. No, it's really good.
Well, because it's made like somewhat realistic in a sense. I mean, it's not like you can kind of the guy can kind of see it like out of. That's kind of how dudes are, dude. Like,
it's really, like, bitch, what like else do I have to give up?
Yeah, it's like he's. Yeah, no, it's a great movie.
Yeah. So yeah, but pretty great good. Movie. November, Ocean's 12, man.
Otaku Random note: Tale. Did you know that they actually cast Ryan Gosling for that because apparently they thought that he was like they wanted to cast like an unattractive kind of goofy looking guy.
I believe it. I believe that just shows you that people are hot because they're told they're hot.
Yeah.
You know?
Like, they wanted to cast what they thought to be.
Like you know why he's hot? Because he got in shape and he's had abs. But you know what? Anybody can get in shape and get abs.
He's become one of my, like, favorite actors.
Oh, yeah.
Him in the movie with Russell, with Russell Crowe, the good guys or whatever.
The other guys?
The other guys?
Yeah, Shane Black, dude. So Shane Black directed that?
That was so such a fun
The other
movie,
guy? Dude.
Ryan Gosling in that was so fun.
Dude, that movie's...
Brad Pitt with Matthew and I growing up, where it was like Brad Pitt was kind of that same dude.
Same way, yeah.
And then it was like, then he started making Fight Club and other
Drew
shit like
on
that.
You.
Yeah. No, yeah, but Ryan Gosling, after Drive, he's good. After
Place Beyond the Pines?
Oh yeah, yeah,
yeah. That was totally different than I thought it would be.
Yeah, but it was like after Drive, it's like okay, you got my respect, and now and then he's in Blade Runner 2049. Like, yeah, dude.
So either way,
he's good. Yeah, he's good. Yeah, palindromes. Oh yeah, paparazzi. Ooh, Passion of the Christ. Yeah, I mean, you can say what you want. It's an amazing movie.
I've never watched that start to finish.
Yeah, it's tough to watch, but it's
Mel Gibson
it's great
happening around that time, right?
I've never watched
it. Huh? Mel Gibson?
Yeah, didn't those over. Phone calls happen or something?
No, it was after.
It was a DWI stuff.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I got you.
Yeah, he didn't care for Jewish people.
Let's
see the perfect score. The Phantom. We know how he feels about it. They killed Jesus.
Who was they, though?
The Phantom of the Opera, Pokemon, The Polar Express. Oh, this is gonna be one of mine, and neither of you have seen this. Primer.
Wow.
Oh, mediocre. Wow.
Primer. This is a movie by Shane Carruth, who's done some one of my favorite movies of all time. Also, Upstream Color, which he did after this, but Primer, he made this for $5,000, and it's arguably the most realistic, quote-unquote, time travel movie that you could probably watch.
Okay.
And it's literally like a guy and his buddy. But he literally made this movie for like $5,000. Like, so you can watch it just to see it, like, knowing and just thinking, okay, wow, that's crazy. Like, but the science, it's kind of like hard sci-fi in the fact that, like, he has, like, some advanced math degree and wanted to start making movies. So it's like, as grounded in reality as you could imagine, but Primer, dude, it's top notch sci-fi. The Prince and Me, Princess Diaries 2, Proud, The Punisher, starring Tom Jane.
Hey, that was a good one.
Was it?
Tom
it wasn't
Jane.
Bad.
It
wasn't
Tom
bad.
Jane.
I'd say it was all right.
The one with what's his name with that's dead now, the Irish, just got that actor who died recently.
He's dead.
Warzone.
Yeah, Punisher Warzone. That one was more violent, wasn't it?
You know who else?
I love that one.
Yeah, that's the one I like more.
McNulty from.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
He was the bad guy.
Jigsaw.
Yeah,
I'm
yeah,
McNulty.
Yep, he's a Brit like they all are.
Oh,
see, raise your voice, raising Helen Ray. Oh, Jamie Foxx, great. Got the best actor for that one. Ryan Giants riding the book.
Anything like?
No,
Jamie
we've
Foxx,
talked about we've yeah, talked about great. It. Yeah, he's great at everything he does. Saved, Hating on Christians, not cool with me. Saw. Oh, the first Saw movie came out this year. Goodness, and James Wan. James Wan, the boy who directed the movie he had me watch the other day. Was it Justice? Broken?
Oh, Descendants?
Descendants, yeah. Yeah, so yeah, directed
Saw
for summer.
One that, like, yeah, it was scary because it was like...
Yeah, it was a new, unique
and
horror like story.
Get put in this situation where it's like you're choosing between two horrible things.
Yeah, it's the lesser of having to choose between those two evils. Scooby-Doo 2. Who cares? Secret Window. Yeah, I mean...
That was a good movie.
I thought it was a pretty good movie.
My story.
Yeah, I know. Oh, yeah, old John Turturro.
Yep.
Yep.
It wasn't a bad movie.
Seed of Chucky.
I thought it was.
No, Secret Window wasn't a bad movie.
I thought they brought it.
Honestly, it was way better than I thought it would be. Shall We Dance? Shark Tale. She Hate Me. Spike Lee joint. Shrek 2. Sideways. Oh, yeah. This Paul Giamatti. Man, that poor guy, I don't know if he's ever going to an Oscar, but... him and Alexander Payne, the director, they just did that, the holdovers.
Paul Giamatti.
Dude, Paul Giamatti's a steam stealer. Hopefully he wins an Academy Award before he dies, because I love Paul Giamatti.
What he needs to do is the Denzel route. He needs to play a horrible villain.
Well, he's played over-the-top villains.
He has.
Well, like, remember Shoot 'Em Up?
Yes, that's what I was going to say. He was a villain in that movie. That's the exact movie I was thinking of.
No, yeah, but...
thing for Training Day.
Yeah. Honestly, Paul Giamatti needs to just tone it down a little bit, and I think it'll be okay. But I love him not toning it down. I think that's what people like. Silver City. Okay, Sky Captain. World of Tomorrow. Sleepover. Some Kind of Monster. Soul Plane. Starring Snoop Dogs. Spanglish. Yeah. Spartan. Speak. Ooh, Spider-Man 2. This is arguably... So, out of the Tobey Maguire Spider-Man trilogy, this is... hands down the best one, Spider-Man 2. And as far as like pre-MCU superhero movies, this is pretty much, you know, there's no argument that this is the best superhero movie that was probably been made. They just it nails it on for many reasons. SpongeBob SquarePants, Stage Beauty.
Really shit.
Starsky and Hutch. That was funny.
I liked it.
That was funny. I remember seeing it on theaters with my then girlfriend, and it was quite funny.
I feel like we all went and saw it, didn't we?
Maybe. I'm pretty sure. I don't think. I mean, maybe y'all did.
Maybe,
but
yeah.
Stepford Wives. That was a remake. Straight Jacket. Super Size Me. Yeah, it was Morgan Spurlock's Academy Award-winning documentary about fast food. Surviving Christmas, Suspect Taxi. Zero, Taking Lives, Taxi. Ugh, Jimmy Fallon, man. I'm glad. He somehow still got a talk show, but whatever. Teacher's Pet. Team America, World Police. You know what? This will offend you, and it should, and it's hilarious. That's all I have to say.
It's like that.
It's hilarious.
It's
like, The Terminal. That's the little news story had me thinking about this movie. And I'm like, not the same thing, but it had me thinking about The Terminal, where he lived in that. This is where he lived in the airport because he was stuck there, and I don't know.
I remember, because he has his passport and stuff.
Exactly. So he was basically living.
Couldn't leave the airport.
Yeah, he couldn't leave the airport for like a very long
time.
It's like
go home. It's like he could either go back home or something.
Oh,
or
shit!
Yeah.
Troy, was that
here? Troy. Oh yeah, Troy. That was pretty good. Yeah, based on the Iliad. Yeah, Brad Pitt, Eric Bana, and Orlando Bloom.
Oh, man.
Twisted, Tying the Knot, Undertow, University Heights, Van Helsing.
Van Helsing.
Because he swings. Vanity Fair. A very long engagement. Ooh, a Shimalama-lama-ding-dong movie, The Village. The Village.
That one, Mikey?
The Village. There's a twist.
It was okay.
Vocus in Innocentes, Voices of Rock, Walking Tall, Dwayne Johnson, based on the movie Walking Tall. That was Walking Tall, so the rundown probably wasn't a remake then.
No, but that one was actually based on a real person.
He walked around with like a board, a 2x4, and beat...
Buford Pusser.
There we go, it's Buford.
Like, and no, it was... Like, the story for the movie, like, as ridiculous as the movie was, it was based on a real person. Like, yeah, really,
that's a, I mean, that's always a cool element.
Somebody named Buford.
No, neither would I. Wake of death, watermarks. We're at the W, so we're getting close.
That's all I know.
We don't live here anymore. Welcome to Mooseport. When will I be loved? Ooh, Mikey, this is your favorite. this is white chicks. This is just to see the Wayans brothers dressed up as white chicks for a whole movie, and anyone, even in the fake world of the movie, to buy that these are white girls. It's just, it makes me laugh. I can't help but laugh. So it's so absurd. But I'll laugh, so I guess it's doing its job. See, Wicker Park, win a date with Ted Hamilton.
No,
without a paddle. Yeah. Without a paddle wasn't bad, really.
So,
Matt Millard, Seth Green, Dax Shepard.
There it is.
The Woodsman. The Walking. Oh, we're almost there. We got a couple left.
Oh,
Woman, Thou Art Loosed.
By Bishop T.D. Jakes.
Okay, and we only got a few left here. The Woodsman. I haven't seen that. It's got Ken Bacon in it. The Work and the Glory. The Year of the Yao. You Got Served. And ending with the strong one, Yu-Gi-Oh! The Movie.
Yeah, that
Pyramid of Light.
And I found my number one pick at the very end. No, I'm kidding.
Yep. So this was a strong year for comedies. I'll say that much.
I was going to say, why don't you go ahead, Matt? Because I literally...
So Primer and Birth are my two main picks.
Okay.
But
keep going.
Kill Bill, I feel like that has to be included with the first one. Anchorman, it has to be there. And man, I can only say so many. And then so I got Primer and Birth, and yeah, I mean there's a bunch. Y'all can give more suggestions, but. Those are the ones I'll mention.
Yeah, no, those are fucking those movies.
So like, and because I'll try and get the weirder ones. So like I said, Birth and Primer for sure, and then yeah, Kill Bill has to be there, and then Anchorman. So
yeah, man. I mean, I'm gonna pass to Chris just because I have so many. I'm still looking through as to like what are my actual picks, because there was a lot of these that I remembered liking for certain reasons, and some of them I wanted to just mention in a way.
Well, it was like,
but.
Okay. Well, yeah,
you can go ahead. If you know your picks, I would say you go ahead, because I'm kind of still working on it, but I have an idea.
So it was like Girl Next Door was one that was like,
okay.
It was just,
yeah, no.
It was one of those where it was like,
yeah, no, you have to tell us why, but you can just.
Well, no, it's not necessarily a top three. It's more so an.
Well, tell us your top three first.
My top three obviously would be like Collateral would be number one.
Okay, there's
Tom
number
Cruise
one.
And Jamie Foxx.
Yeah,
like
that's
movie
and I knew that one of I knew y'all would cover me there. And I know.
No, because that movie was just.
So in number two.
Like I don't even. It's like I don't even want to give too much.
Oh yeah, dude. No, it's just.
If you haven't seen it, then just
yeah, dude.
Go watch it. It's
Michael Mann doing his thing.
Oh my god, it's so good. Troy. Was probably number two.
Not like, didn't start with the man, huh? I'm surprised.
Man on Fire.
Yeah, I thought that would have been number two.
No, maybe because of man. I mean, it's like I feel like we gave Man on Fire enough of like.
Yeah,
you
that's
know,
that's
what the
kinda,
fuck it was. It's Man on Fire is one that like it's not going to be on my honorable mentions because it's like
it's
I just
on
feel
my top
like
list.
That's like
yeah
Man
that's
on Fire
that's what I'm saying like
it's
the top movie for me so yeah
but, yeah like I have
so
two top
like,
ones but then I had to mention a few others
exactly,
so that's what I'm saying
exactly.
Yeah
out of this year I feel like it would be Collateral number two would be Troy
okay
and then probably number three would be Dawn of the Dead.
Okay.
I would say because...
Yeah, I'm glad you got that. I'm glad
know,
you covered that
and
one.
Then, like I said, it was like Butterfly Effect was good. It was like if you watched Butterfly Effect, I would suggest watching the DVD version where you could see all of the different alternate endings. Because it was like I really didn't give a shit about that movie in the theater. But when my old roommate bought it, on DVD and you watched all the alternate endings.
Yeah, and DVDs were relatively still kind of
they are.
In the new then. So it was cool.
Yeah.
It was like, wow,
was
you're really getting a lot out of buying a DVD because
like,
of that feature.
You could see where it was like nothing really in the movie up to that point changed. It was just like how it ended and you're like, oh my God, this is how it ended. And he did this and this is...
Yeah.
Know.
No, that's a good one for people to see.
And so, yeah, you know, Crash was good. Saw was good. And like
yeah,
I
it's
said,
so hard
Girl
to pick for
door,
me in some
no,
of the sense.
Like, but you see the way we're doing it, so it's kind of make sure the ones are mentioned that you feel need to
be
mentioned.
That's what I was gonna
pick
say.
Your top two absolutes, and then
and then
just read your list.
I'm gonna say my top two just to be trying and I'm gonna encompass both. The Alamo. I know y'all were saying y'all
okay.
really seen it. The Alamo is the
okay.
Top
I'm
one
glad.
For me.
So I want to see it now.
Anchorman. I would say that to me, it's a comedy, and to me, it's one of the top. The Anchorman
dude
kind of surpasses it's I don't know man I don't even know how to describe it
it's comic genius dude it's
the Alamo
so
is one that I remember when it came out. I remember waiting to see the Alamo, but it's one that I only ever saw in theaters, and then after
I thought
it
was
out,
good
I
thought Billy Bob Thornton playing
yeah Billy Bob
Davy Crockett
was
good
and everything
or did
he played Davy Crockett or
Crockett or Bowie. I think
he was Crockett. No, Bowie was the other guy. Bowie was one that died.
But either way, it was...
Okay.
But then, so the Alamo and Anchorman, and then my third one would have to be Lady Killers.
Okay, dude, okay.
Cohen, like, I gotta put in Lady Killers.
Yeah.
And then, so I would have to make that my top three movies.
Okay.
And as far as honorable mentions, and I can't really rank them above each other.
Yeah, don't have to,
I would say Club Dread is in there.
Yes, good.
I have
yes.
to put Club Dread,
yes.
Man on Fire, like
yes.
we were talking about, Team America.
Yes.
Like, Team America was the first of its kind. In that,
and the only of its kind.
In, exactly, and it was super offensive. It offended everybody.
Basketball with puppets.
They didn't leave anybody out, and the fact that it was puppets and everything.
Yeah.
The way they did it, and it was so well executed, I don't see how you can't not like it.
Yeah.
Or how you could be like, oh, I don't think, whatever. So, and then I guess, and then again, another one for an honorable mention would have to be Love Song for Bobby Long.
Okay.
I really like
okay.
that movie. We had John Travolta in it. One of the only John Travolta
What's that movie
really
about?
Is he's Bobby Long was an actual, like, professor or something that turned out to, it might have also been, like, a poet or whatnot. Turned out to kind of just somewhat be a drunk, but he was like, I don't know, man. It's a really interesting movie. The
okay.
guy that wrote an actual song about him, Love Song for Bobby
yeah.
Long. He wrote a song. They made a movie. I mean, it was a really good movie.
So it's moving.
It's more or less of a drama.
It hits
yeah,
the heartstrings.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Well, not just the heartstrings, but it's also it's kind of a reality.
Okay.
It's not something that's
Yeah, it's well grounded. It's
yeah,
just
exactly.
it's like it's people you can really you watch it, and these are people you can
yes.
you might
it,
see in your everyday life.
Yeah, and it captures the whole area and everything, the lighting
okay.
stuff we've talked about and other things.
Okay.
And then of course you can't even like you said, Kill Bill was in there.
Yeah.
You can't really it goes along.
Kill
it's a
Bill
whole movie
is
in
like
and of itself.
All three of them.
Exactly.
Yeah, well, yeah,
like
two.
You,
there's
which
just
year of Kill
the
Bill
two.
Do you
yeah.
pick? It's
and,
like you pick all of them.
And I'll preface it with saying it's See again, Harold and Kumar.
No, yeah,
mentioning.
It's like,
I've got
yeah. But then,
as much as I don't care about that movie, that one scene with that freaking dude that you're talking about
clapping,
is
yes.
so freaking fun.
Like,
I heard everything
it.
You boys said.
Say
Me
it,
and your
yes.
brother Caleb
yes.
would quote that so well. Freak I heard show. Everything
like,
you boys
and
said.
And that's what I'm saying about how it's such a good movie. Yeah,
like,
Secret Window.
Secret Window is the only one that was on my list that I didn't
like yeah.
to, but it was like, it was one of those. That
and
like,
that's what I'm saying. I mean, we listen to like 100 movies. It's good to give the people a handful.
No, yeah,
you know, but
really
we let them know our top ones, but it's good to let them know other
yeah,
ones.
And
so
I would say
all of it just
yeah.
to like get an idea.
I want
to
mention this movie just
none of y'all met in The Notebook, but it should be mentioned.
The Notebook,
too.
Yeah.
Notebook,
yeah.
Is,
Notebook,
I
no,
but yeah,
it's in
so,
there. It's
yeah,
in there.
Yeah.
If you got a chick, she hasn't seen it for whatever
Even if
reason.
You don't have a chick.
That's a dude.
Yeah.
Like, get
yeah,
out
you'll
here.
Probably cry.
You'll see. It'll make you cry.
So,
you'll
one that
you'll
I think
cry.
Goes worth mentioning in this, not saying it's a top, but just on the basis of like plot and everything, The Village.
Okay.
I didn't I'm not talking about execution or anything like that, but just the plot and again what I meant about like the butterfly effect being a good foray into something.
Yeah.
I also think The Village might have been a good foray into something for people that would have never, you know, cuz I wasn't expecting it when I watched
yeah.
it to be.
Did
that
you had you seen The Sixth Sense before you saw that?
Yes, but I wasn't like old enough to really
we
remember.
We weren't quite like inoculated to
okay.
the M. Night Shyamalan movie.
See, I just happened,
yeah.
for whatever reason, I was staying with my buddy Milner in middle school, and his sister took us, like, I didn't have any care about The Sixth Sense, but, like, I think it was, like, opening weekend. She's like, oh, let's go see it, and we're like, okay, and went and saw it, and it was, like, literally the first weekend it came out, and it was like, oh my gosh, you know, like it was like one of those cultural movies because the twist was so well done.
Yeah, the red door.
You know, it was so well done. So, and then I was like, oh, okay. And honestly, I've never even seen The Village. I know with the twist, but I've never seen it. So.
You ever seen it?
No.
No, but it's.
But I know the. But I know. I say things. I know the twist is the thing. So I don't even know if like
but
I.
It's one of those.
Like is it? Should I go back and watch it, even knowing the twist?
Maybe, I mean, maybe just because of like understanding what it was they were trying to accomplish.
Yeah.
What it was they were trying to accomplish was like keeping a group of people confined and like.
Yeah.
We have our ways. Don't venture outside because if you venture outside of our ways, like.
Yeah.
This will get
it's the bigger picture of the controlling of information.
Yeah.
The fact that it's like these people were able to control the information on this small populace. And so it's just kind of interesting in that aspect. Regardless, like it's like exactly
what information control, indoctrination, but just all that stuff. Kind
of. Well, but then it plants the seed. It's like the tree of the knowledge of good and evil.
Yeah.
So it's like if they escape that place and they understand that there's a whole world outside of there. It's like now you have this understanding beyond everything you've understood.
Electricity. So there you go, guys. That's 2004. I think you want there's a good chunk of movies for you that there's something there hopefully for everybody. A lot of comedy, strong year for comedies, that's for sure. But yeah, good stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Good stuff, guys. Well, I think that brings us close to the end here, probably.
Okay.
If there's anything you'd like to recommend for the week,
I would recommend to treat yourself to an ice cream cone.
Okay.
That would be it. Ice cream cone.
Go get yourself an ice cream cone.
When was the last time you had an ice cream cone?
An actual cone? It's been a while. I had ice cream last night, but I didn't have a cone.
See?
No, yes, so.
Exactly. The cone. So you could even just go buy cones because my grandmother used to have them all the time at the house. She would have the little cones, and you could just scoop a little scoops, and you could have your own.
Yeah, and honestly, you could use, you don't even need that. You can use an ice cream cone, put peanut butter and jelly in there.
You can do whatever you want. Build yourself a little, you know, treat yourself.
Yeah, make yourself a little.
That's my recommendation of the week.
That's good. Treat yourself with an ice cream cone.
Well, ice cream cone.
Well, there you go.
I would say, do your best to just be the best person you can in every situation.
You can't go wrong being the best.
Like, I had a situation the other week where it was like, it's hard to bring it up without sounding like it's like bragging or something. But it's like, the other week, I went in and paid for gas. It was like, I need $10 on pump six, you know? And I went out, I fucking started pumping my gas. I didn't pay with my card. It was like I paid cash. And I looked over and I noticed that the pump was like running up past $10. It was like I prepaid $10.
Yeah.
And
so you could have stolen the gas if you wanted to.
I could have just fucking pulled it out at that point and
fucking like normal
driven off. But it was like
any responsible man does, he pull out.
I just ran it up to an even $11, you know, whatever. And then when I was finished, I guess I felt like I was faced with the choice was, you know, where it was like, nobody's going to know if I drive away and just, you know,
it's like if you just skirt off.
Yeah.
Just
no, yeah.
A fucking dollar. And in the grand scheme of things, what's it fucking matter? You know.
But it was the right thing to do.
I didn't want the girl working the register to get her ass in a sling because her till was a dollar short at the end of the day.
Yeah, doing the right thing when no one's looking.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what it is.
And she looked at me like I was stupid.
She's like, "Why didn't you just leave?" Yeah. She's thinking.
No, well, and I told her, I was like, look, I think you ran my shit up like I was running with a card. I paid cash. Like, you just kept it running. I owe you a dollar. She's like, but so what? I was like, I owe you a dollar. Here, take it. Put it in the
register. Yeah, you didn't want to steal. And, this is basically.
Yeah, and it's just.
No, that's a, it's,
know, it's one of those things where it's like, and probably at the end of the week, I came out short, you know?
Yeah.
Where it's like.
Yeah, but yeah, you did the right thing in a situation like, where it was given to you on a platter to walk away.
And it's like, yeah. You know.
You decided not
to. Yeah, he was a good man.
Do the right thing when nobody's watching.
Yeah,
you know, and yep. that's
a good way to sum it up. Is
that's the definition,
and that's what you did, man.
Being a good person.
So like, that's good.
What do you do when nobody's fucking watching.
Yeah, it's being a good example of a good person for yourself, which is good.
You
exercise that muscle, you know.
Well, and you don't do it to get something back.
Exactly.
And eventually, though, you will get it back. It's like for that.
Yeah.
It's like, and it may take you a long fucking time to get it back.
Yeah. But let me say, some people might never get it back, but that's the thing.
They will once they realize that the point of doing it is not to get it back.
Yeah. I mean,
once you get past that block, that it's like, I do this freely because it's what you're supposed to do as a human being.
And being a good human,
then that's when you get it back. It's like what Mikey talks about with Alan Watts. It's like giving it freely and giving it back because it was never yours to begin with.
Yeah, be generous. That's kind of so. Yeah, that's just a that feeds mine. I'd be like, well, you know, fine. Be gentle. That's actually my recommendation is
piggybacking.
it's a natural. It's not actually because doing the right thing. I'm saying, it's just a natural conversation.
No, it is.
Be true. Generous.
Yeah.
If you don't have the opportunity naturally, make the opportunity.
You'll be generous. You'll be amazed at the ways in which you get it back.
Yeah, like, and it's
ways you never expected it.
And I love it. I love any opportunity to be just like whenever I go out to eat, which I don't go out to eat that often, but like we did for Kev's birthday last night.
Yeah.
And I used to wait tables. So like I tell Steffi, I'm excited to pay the bill because the waitress doesn't know who they're dealing with, right?
Uh-huh.
You know, just because like I waited tables in college. So, and she did a good job. But even if she didn't, like, I'm
going to help her.
They're going to get like, at least $20 or more for me.
Yeah, because you
know?
Never go out to eat. You're
yeah,
able to spend that money.
Exactly. Yeah. If I went out to eat like 3 times a week, I wouldn't be doing that.
Yeah.
But it's just like, but yeah. So yes, be generous. You know, and it didn't always mean money. It can be time. Being generous with your time.
Like,
be generous with your emotion. You know, just being generous with your love. You know, just
absolutely.
Like what Gandhi said. You know, where Gandhi talked about, like, be the change in the world that you want to see.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like,
you know,
Caleb said that.
And it's like,
oh, well, that was his way.
You know, it's like, I've always said that, but I didn't.
But then Gandhi tried to say that he said it first.
Gandhi tried to take his shit.
Well, no, it's one of
and
those
who dead now?
Always,
who
I've
dead
always
now?
Said, but I didn't know who to attribute quote to. And then at one point, somebody was like, okay, Gandhi. And it was like, oh, okay, he said it? Well,
yep.
Cool. Now I know who to attribute.
Change the world if you want to pee.
So if you wanted to be able to accomplish all of what we said, you could go buy an ice cream cone, and while you're doing it, be kind to people on your way and buy someone else an ice cream cone.
There you go.
You could do all of it by doing that.
Yeah. So give if you hopefully compliment the person you're buying it from. And then buy one for the person behind you.
Or just some dude that you saw on the corner, just some homeless guy looking for money. You bless his day.
Yeah, throw an ice cream cone in his face.
Money. Like you're saying, throw him some money, maybe.
Yeah.
I feel like that's kind of what he's saying,
the
too.
The thing is, you can throw it at him, and they'll still take
it.
Just throw it at him. Just chunk it.
You gotta respect him as a person. You gotta let him know that. Like,
yeah, I guess
hey,
you
man,
should. They are humans.
We're all the same. We're all on the
We show. All bleed red. And
wouldn't it be crazy, though, one of those money machines, you know, you just put where they just threw change at you? You stood in it instead of the dollar bills floating around?
There's a bunch of quarters getting shot
at
up.
Oh, shit.
Ting, ting.
Yeah. That suck, dude. Just put a mouth guard in.
You gotta be dumb.
Yeah, put a mouth guard in on that one.
There's
your
song.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, guys. Well,
thank you guys for joining us.
It's
I hope
been
you
real.
Enjoyed some of the random topics and our jargon here and there. And thanks for joining us, Matthew.
Yeah, and Mikey's has a pencil. Probably and good job. Like. Till next week. Much love, one love.